Hey there, Cassandra here, the Vintage Arcade Gal, and it's been a hot minute since I've made one of these videos, but don't think for a minute that we haven't been busy down here in the Arcade Workshop, because the opposite is true. We're going to look at a lot of things today. First up, we're going to take a look at the finished Simpsons restoration. It looks beautiful, it's wonderful, and one of the side kind of bars of doing that restoration was I ordered way too much wood. We only used like 40% of the wood I ordered to fix that cabinet. So with that extra wood, we decided we were going to do a super special project with it. And of course, like a lot of things, that has now taken precedent and has pushed some of the other projects off to the side. But we have made progress with the Space Area project and the Donkey Kong project, but I'm not going to talk about those in this video because we haven't really done enough to really make it worthwhile showing you anything. The other thing I want to talk about is over the last couple weeks, I've had some people come to the workshop for me to fix their arcade games, and online, a lot of people asking questions. And there's a lot of confusion about power supplies, specifically the Atari power supply system, which is very easy to repair and not so easy to replace. So I think the Atari power supplies are a great instance as if you are kind of shaky on the idea of repairing your own arcade games. It's a great place to start because they're really, really, really simple to fix and keep running reliably. So we're going to take a look at those, take the mystery out of the Atari power supplies. But first up, let's take a look at the Simpsons restoration. So here's a real quick recap of this project in case you haven't seen the other videos. About 3.5 years ago, I bought this Simpsons upright Konami game, which had a lot of heavy water damage on the bottom and a broken front panel and some internal issues. So I've been deciding to do this project for a while and just felt kind of hesitant because of my woodworking skills, but we decided to go for it and we built a brand new front of the game using the original specs of the cabinet. Including rabbit slots and the like. And then we literally cut off the bottom of the cabinet and rebuilt the entire bottom base where the water damage had occurred with some clever woodworking from some other collectors who had kind of helped me along the way here. We were able to almost seamlessly recreate the damage bit to as good as new. And now, all we really need to do here is paint the cabinet, get the internals working, and put our side art on finally to have a finished game. So after a bit of sanding, I really wanted to make sure the sides were as smooth as possible because I was not planning on painting or priming the sides, which I know is kind of controversial, but that's just how the game was originally. I sanded down and repaired as much as I could to the imperfections in the wood, and started to paint and sand and paint and sand to give the best possible look I could. Sometimes you may laminate these front pieces. I did not this time because my Simpsons cabinet was not laminated originally, but you can see here the finished product. It looks really darn nice, and now we're ready for the side art. Now here's where my approach might be a little controversial. The original Simpsons side art and these Konami games in general, these four-player games, the artwork was actually placed on the game in three different sections. And I decided to reproduce that to make it as authentic as possible. You really have to be careful here though, because the size parameters for the side art, it's very, very tight. And I've seen some really, really crappy Simpsons and Turtles restorations where the art was printed incorrectly, or the application was not careful, and so the artist cut off incorrectly. And it is a very tight squeeze on the Simpsons from left to right for the logo and for the characters themselves. So, you know, all I did here was cut it into three sections, measuring from what I had originally measured from the cabinet, how it was separated, and then applied each section carefully. I like to use a rubber roller to make sure everything's kind of squeezed down there really nicely, and a heat gun very carefully on a low setting, kind of far away from the art, to stretch out any sort of imperfections. And we did both sides and it just looks great. And actually my seam is much smoother and almost invisible in some areas compared to the original scene on the game. I don't know if that's just the way it was applied or that this artwork is probably a better quality than the original, or just that I was more careful than the original people who assembled the cabinet out of Konami's factory. Next up was the least exciting game to restore these coin mechs, and they were just a mess. Like the front of the game, they had gotten kicked in and abused. I did the best I could with these. They really need to be replaced. The problem is that the modern equivalent are slightly different. So I sanded these and bent out the metal the best I could. Normally on a prestige game like this, I would get these powder coated. I didn't bother. I just painted them the best I could. Hopefully I can find better replacements in the future. There in the bottom, you can see my new power supply being installed as well. And we started to put the wiring together in the game and getting the coin mechs together the best we could. I even decided to kind of be fun and put a little Simpsons characters in the coin thing just because it makes me happy. And then we also went ahead and put these decals on to help the player decide which coin slot is theirs. These are normally missing, but these are reproducible and available from a lot of places. And we also put new labels on the back, restoring the serial number so everything is proper again. You can really see that paint looks pretty darn good. And continue wiring the cabinet and putting the monitor in so it would be totally playable. And the game is pretty much done here at this point and ready to go. And it looks really great. All right, so here we are, the finished product, totally restored. It looks great. Our 25-inch Wells Gardner monitor, totally restored. Originally, it had some sort of third-party chassis in it that was just garbage. So I got a new 7000 rebuilt chassis to add to the tube. The tube still looks great. A lot of years left in this thing. Our new Wico sticks, new old stock Wico sticks, and the correct colors. The buttons are actually the original buttons still. All the artwork, the control panel, the marquee, the side art, that was all created by this old game. And a word of caution again about Simpsons side art and art in particular, it's normally printed wrong, either sizing wise or the color teal that's used in the Simpsons art is a very difficult color for inkjet printers to reproduce correctly. So I really recommend this old game for a lot of things, but the Simpsons art in particular, they're really the only place I've ever seen that does it justice. Otherwise, I mean, I put this pink tea molding on it. A lot of people like to put yellow on the Simpsons cabinet to match, you know, the faces and the logo color and whatnot. But the game originally would have been shipped with just regular black tea molding. But I thought the pink was a little more fun and festive. It matches the circle and the pink line on the control panel. It just pops. It's kind of like Homer's pink donut he likes to eat. And originally I was planning actually on flipping this game or trading it to somebody for something else, but now that I've restored it, I just have fallen in love with it all over again. The plan also is to put a switcher in here to play other Konami 4-player games, such as Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Sunset Riders, etc. But I'll have to accumulate those boards over time, and some of those boards can be pretty expensive to track down. You know, Turtles in Time especially, spend like $1,000 on that board, so we'll see if I get lucky in the future. Anyway, there's a Simpsons. You're probably asking yourself why it's not in the arcade, because we're out of space upstairs, and this is a big mama jama. It's a big cabinet, so it's just either going to have to wait till we bring something downstairs to the workshop to kind of store for a while, or until we reconfigure the arcade somehow. Anyway, but speaking of the arcade, let's go upstairs and talk about the next project we're working on. Okay, so behind me I've got two Atari Cabaret versions of arcade games. We have a Centipede and we have a Battle Zone. These Cabaret cabinets were rather low-produced cabinets compared to the full-size upright versions. Not all games came out in cabarets from Atari or any other manufacturer. And collectors love these things because they're so small and they're easy to put into, well, wherever, especially a home. And also the rarity makes them rather collectible. Now, not
all games that were released by either Atari or other major manufacturers came as cabarets. But I've always kind of wanted to make a cabaret cabinet from scratch. And with our extra wood left over from our Simpsons project, I figured it would be an ideal time to do something really, really unique.
Now, back in the early 80s, if you bought an Atari 2600 game, there was a good bet it came with a free comic book known as Atari Force. Now, Atari Force was created by DC Comics, who was owned by Warner Brothers Communications, which also owned Atari back in the late 70s and early 80s. And Atari Force was an attempt to create a series of licensable characters that Atari and Warner Brothers could use for future games or merchandise or licensing opportunities. Now, I'm not going to go into the full history of Atari Force in this video. I'm going to save that for a future video. But one of the big hallmarks of Atari Force was to create an arcade game known as Atari Force Liberator. And it is actually one of the rarest arcade games that Atari has ever made. Now, there are a number of rare Atari arcade games from the early 80s that are very, very popular with collectors. Games like Quantum, which only about 500 are made, or iRobot, which about 750 are made. But just as rare is Liberator, with less than 800 made. But Liberator was such a flop almost out from the get-go, and today it's not really remembered. Recently, while investigating kind of the history of Liberator, I have gotten a hold of over 200 pages of Atari documentation about the development of Liberator. And I'm going to do a special video just on Liberator in the future as far as the history and the development of the game. I'm not quite ready to spill those beans yet, but it's important to think about. This game is very rare, was kind of shunned, and originally it was supposed to come out not only in an upright cabinet, but also a European version, and a cabaret was originally on the books. But since Atari presented the game and they're like, ta-da, check it out, and everyone was like, eh, not so much, all those plans are shelved. Thanks to eBay, I have picked up a decent PCB of Liberator, which is very hard to find. It's semi-working, hopefully fully to be working. I should have those parts in my hand in a couple days. And I was going to make a Liberator cabinet from scratch. And we've already started and we're pretty far along. So let's check out the process of, or the progress of this project. Okay, so filled with all sorts of confidence because of our last triumph with the woodworking, rebuilding the Simpsons cabinet, I have this dream to make a cabaret Liberator. I based this design off the Battlezone cabaret, which I felt would be probably what they would have used since it's a horizontal monitor. And there are my pinouts. Pinouts were not available specifically online for this game as I attempted to make a wiring harness. We'll talk a little bit about more of that in a minute. There's our board I got off eBay. It's missing a couple chips, but that will soon be resolved. But it is actually powering up and attempting to boot, so that's a good sign. It's in actually a really nice shape, just a little dirty. And that's our audio regulator board. And we're going to talk a little bit more about audio regulator boards in a moment. So I used the drawing set as well as our actual battle zone as a template. And a lot of people use these things to throw them in a CNC machine, which would be super fancy, but we are not fancy, and we did it the other way, and we just decided to measure it out and make it by hand. So here's our big piece of essentially particle board that was left over from the Simpsons, and we're cutting it to make our sides and shaped, and voila. And this is just from measurements, and there you see our curves to round out the edges, and it's a little bit bigger than it should be now. And to kind of finite this, we're just gonna use a router, and you want to do both sides, or both of, anytime you have two of anything, it's something like this, of course you make them at the same time to make sure everything is perfectly even. So, you know, hopefully you're not off at all from the measurements, but if you are, at least everything is exactly the same. So it will fit together correctly and as true as possible. And I cannot emphasize enough the positives of owning a plunge router. It has been a godsend for arcade repair, and there are our sides looking pretty spiffy. Now, one of the more complicated aspects of this cabaret design is actually the speaker box that goes underneath that holds also the coin bucket and holds the audio regulator board. And this required a lot of interesting clamping work and measurement to make sure everything was just perfect. Now, that the circle cut would have been a lot easier, especially with the CNC. Here we are checking measurements and cutting more and more wood for the interior pieces as well. As you can see, it's starting to take shape there. This is the back piece where you have the slot for the power, and on to the left of this picture, you can see the rails that will become the support of the cabinet itself. The back piece on the top is also a little bit of a challenge. It kind of creates a faux vent for the monitor. We used a lot of glue here to create these pieces. Constantly remeasuring, you can get all of these AutoCAD programs for free and download the plans for these things online. There are more of our pieces and parts. You can see it's just kind of a puzzle piece. This front section where the coin bucket, the speaker grill, and the marquee sit, probably the most complicated. You can see we're not using particle board for this because this is how our battle zone is made. I don't know why, but this is just how it is. So we decided to use the same kind of materials. And then we start putting our side support rails on to connect the cabinet together, exactly how Atari was made. Now, Atari would have used a staple kind of gun device, but we don't have that. We just use screws. Carefully measuring, making sure everything is exactly the same here. And we got to the point of a test fitting. Everything is just, man, it's looking super duper pretty close. It's amazing, actually. Just it took a couple weekends to get to this far, this point, and it's starting to look pretty legit, even though everything's not permanently connected. We're just trying to checking our fittings to make sure everything is as even, Steven, as possible. Now, most Atari games would have had a metal control panel, which we unfortunately don't have the skills to reproduce something that never existed in metal, so we actually decided to make the control panel out of wood, much like some of the Williams control panels. And here we are gluing the pieces together, trying to get exactly the correct angle, again using a table saw and a router to cut these pieces and glue them with clamps. And voila, there's our control panel with kind of the test graphic. And here you can see as we plan out trackball, there's two black buttons, a shield, a fire button, and two cone buttons for player one, player two. Using our plunge router again, to create a hole for the trackball. And here you can see it's a metal plate. They use these a lot of times for main controls, so we're going to utilize it here. And everything fit together pretty well. We have yet to drill our holes for our other buttons yet, but we're pretty happy with our wood control panel. And once the real overlay's on there, it's going to look really amazing. Now, behind the scenes, while we were doing all this woodwork, I was attempting to make a wiring harness for this game out of a modified centipede wiring harness, and it turned out just to be a disaster. It wasn't working out for me. So there's a guy named Travis Reynolds who makes these custom arcade game harnesses. He'll make anything you want with the original specs, and it's pretty amazing work. And these are all his pictures of him making my Liberator Cabaret harness, so making something that technically never existed, but making it to the exact Atari specifications, all the right pinouts and all the right plugs. So it's just perfect as perfect can be, and I'm very thankful for Travis's hard work. This is really going to pay dividends when we get the game completely together at the end. It's going to make things a lot easier, and now I don't have to stress about the wiring harness. With our interiors assembled, our side interiors, I went ahead and painted them. The outside of this will receive wood grain veneer laminate, and the front and the top will also receive black laminate. Those should arrive pretty soon. Now, the side art for the upright is pretty cool, but mathematically it doesn't really work for a cabaret, and a lot of times the cabaret side art would be slightly different. So I actually made my own side art for the cabaret cabinet. I think it's pretty slick. I kind of modeled this after some of the other cabaret artwork, and I really like the use of the integration of the Atari logo. And here I am testing the artwork sizing. This is just stuff I printed from my inkjet printer, but we'll send it off to a proper print shop. Probably one of the people I order a lot of stuff from to get it done correctly with the marquee and the control panel. And we're almost at that point. We just have to put the veneer on first. And think I ended up sizing it a little bit differently. So we're getting pretty close, honestly. Here are all my parts for the cart. And then I also recreated these back labels for the game and put those on the back piece, little back fit piece. So that's looking pretty good and pretty normal for an Atari game, or what it would look like if Atari had actually went ahead and made a cabaret. So as I mentioned in the top of the video, I've had a number of people come by the shop and email me online trying to diagnose problems with their arcade games. Specifically, a lot of the games have been Atari arcade games from the classic era of like about 79 to about 84. And these games utilize a very specific power system. Now, most classic arcade games, if you run into power problems, which is the first thing you should always check whenever trying to diagnose what's wrong with an arcade game, a lot of times you can just switch it out with a switching power supply, which is a modern equivalent, and they make a lot of adapter kits available for specific arcade games. And some of these classic arcade game brands, unfortunately, they all had their own version of the way the power system worked. Some were not as reliable as others, like the Tato ones in particular, they're just terrible. Some can be rebuilt. I like rebuilding the Williams ones, but the Atari ones are very, very unique in the way they distribute power and their design. And the great thing about it is they are pretty easily fixable and easy to make reliable. And it's a great stepping stone if you're not super comfortable with working on like the technical bits of arcade games. They're pretty forgiving, and it's a great way to learn basically how to fix these things. So I want to give you just a brief overview of how these systems work. Now, this is by no means a full look at the Audio Regulator 2 and Power Brick systems in these games. It's just intended to kind of give you a gentle introduction to how they work and some common problems you may run into with these things. All right, let's do it. So this is your basic 101 rundown of the power supply systems for Atari arcade games. And it's made of two parts. And it's important to keep in mind that you have the power brick on the bottom and the Audio Regulator 2 board above it, and they work in cahoots to give power to the entire game. Now, there's lots of variations of both the power brick and the Audio Regulator 2 board, and they're not necessarily intercompatible. So it's important that you have the right one, although there are much more variations of the Audio Regulator 2 board than the power brick below. Power brick is always going to be in the bottom of the game, and they're always going to kind of look the same. And then the Audio Regulator board just depends upon the game where it's located, but it feeds from the power brick. So let's kind of follow the journey here of the power from the wall to the power supply system. And the first thing you're going to see is on the right hand side of the power brick, you're going to see a little plug. And what that little plastic plug plugs into is actually it goes out to the wall plug that you plug your arcade game in. Now, these pins and things, it's important to keep in mind, they can break. They're just plastic, and they have these little Molex pins inside that break. So that's something to check too, in case you have a head scratching moment. But to the left of that, you see these two bolts. But underneath of those two bolts on the opposite side, you have what they call an RFI filter. These rarely go bad. Sometimes they can. It's just a device that helps curb interference. To the left of that is the F1 fuse. This is the main fuse for the arcade game. So if you turn the game on and there's absolutely nothing going on, no lights or sounds or anything, check this fuse. It's probably this. If the fuse is still good, check the holder. The holders are just plastic metal and they do break and they're easily replaceable. To the left of those, you don't really have to worry about that. Those are regional connects for different areas of the world. And the power that goes out, I think that power goes up to the monitor there. And then you have the main fuse banks, and these can have 4 or 5, depending upon what version of the power brick you have. Of course, check the fuses. Check also for corrosion in the terminal, and if the terminals are broken and making good connectivity. If the fuse looks suspect, go ahead and change it. Even if it's testing correctly, sometimes these things get corroded over the years, and they're really not making enough of a connection to make the game go. Now, underneath the fuse box, what you're going to see is a rectifier. These can go bad, but it's rare. So check that and make sure if you have to replace it or decide to replace it, keep in mind there's a positive and a negative to these things. The inputs have to be maintained and you have to replace it with exactly the same kind of rectifier or you're going to run into trouble. Above that is the main plug that goes into the audio regulator board, which we'll talk about in a second. And to the right of that, you have what's called the big blue capacitor. Now, notice mine is black because I've replaced it from the original blue one. Some people will tell you these things never ever go bad. That is not true. They do go bad. They're easily replaced. And I would say if you recap your monitor, go ahead and replace the big blue. I've noticed some problems over the years that can't be traced to anything else. And I replaced the big blue and everything works. Now, the last thing on our little journey of the power brick is the isolation transformer. In the last 25 years of collecting, I've only ever seen one of these go bad. This is basically designed so operators don't kill themselves trying to work on the CRT monitor. And that's pretty much it for the power brick. So let's move on to the audio regulator 2 board. Unlike the power brick, the audio regulator 2 board is going to normally have to be rebuilt. Especially if it is original, these parts dry out and break, and the audio regulator board can be a little fussy. Now, keep in mind, audio regulator 2 boards are all a little different, and they're not necessarily compatible with each other, but some are cross-compatible. You can tell which version that you have by either looking at the manual or looking at the number written on the board. The last two numbers are the designated version. So it is critical that you have the right one. Since some of these games are not intercompatible, they have different voltage requirements and so on, especially the licensed games like the Namco games like Pole Position and Dig Dug from Atari, or the Sun Electronic games like Kangaroo or Arabian. So there's some mods you can do to this board that I'm not going to get into to make more reliable. I'm just going to give you kind of the basic rundown of how to fix most problems or what the heck these things are. So what you're gonna see on your audio regulator board is you're just gonna see the typical range of electronics on these boards. You're going to see the capacitors, which will probably need to be replaced if they have never been replaced. You're gonna see diodes. These tend to go bad pretty quickly. You're gonna have transistors. This is a high output transistor in the middle. You're gonna have your power regulators and other transistors, and you're also going to have resistors on this board. All these things can go bad. So that's great, Cassie. But how does that help me? Well, the first thing you want to do is get yourself a cap kit. These cap and get well kits are available from a lot of different places around the internet, and you want to go ahead and replace all the capacitors. These are also going to have a number of the transistors that are going to need to be replaced, and the resistors as well. This is your first step. Another thing to check are the connectors, not just for broken pins and whatnot, but these things get a lot of abuse when they get plugged and plugged out. You have to be a little violent with them, try to be careful, but what happens is the solder underneath them gets loose or broken and the connection goes bad. So these will probably have to be re-soldered. It's just a good best practice to do that. That will solve some problems as well. Most audio regulator boards will have test points, I think except for the third version. It's a little harder to test that one for the different voltage outputs. So use your multimeter here to test and make sure that the voltage points coming from the audio regulator board are all correct. If you're missing some, especially the 5-volt seems to be the most problematic, then you've got some more work to do with either your power brick or your audio regulator board. Another common fail point, and these should be in most cap kits, are the first little resistor here, which I believe is the R30 resistor, and the first diode, which is a CR1. These fail pretty often because of a lot of problems, but it's kind of a fail-safe, actually. The board will fry this resistor, and sometimes you'll see one of these audio regulator boards, and it'll be totally black and just destroyed. This little resistor, and it's kind of a fail-safe. If something's wrong with the PCB, often if it's a dirty edge connector on your main PCB or something else is wrong, this will kind of, they'll go bluey to protect the board. And some other problems you'll see, there's online, there's a lot of writing about what they call a sense mod, which is a good thing to do if you are continually having problems. I don't particularly like the Sense mod. I don't have anything in my arcade that has a Sense mod, but it's really up to you. Tread with caution on that. One last thing I'll mention is something that's kind of tricky to solder if you're kind of new at soldering, and that is this thing called a Q1, and it's a 5-volt linear voltage regulator. Now, 5 volts is required for all Atari arcade game boards to function. So if you're testing your audio regulator board, or for some reason your PCB is not getting 5 volts, it's a good bet on the audio regulator. It's this little Q1 thing, and it's kind of tricky because there's a lot of little tiny solder points, but I have found this is almost always the main culprit of a 5-volt issue. And you can see to the right of that, there's also a little adjustment. And that actually adjusts how much or how little the voltage goes from the board. So if you're not quite getting a full 5 volts or the right voltage on the board, you can creep that up there. It's also important to remember that voltage kind of dissipates as it goes through the board. So if you have exactly 5 volts coming out of this thing, you may run into problems as it heads down the line of the PCB as voltage starts to slowly drop off. So you might want to tweak that just a little bit more, but don't go crazy. But I have found this Q1 to be a big problem for me in the past. So definitely replace that as well. Just be very careful. It's kind of a tricky thing to solder. So hopefully some of that information on the power supply system for Atari games is useful to you. It's again, you could spend a lot of time diving into, especially the audio regulator board, and I've had some which have been very problematic, and I've almost had to replace every single part until I finally got the stupid thing to work. But that should give you a good basic knowledge of that system, and that's all I've got for this video. Shouldn't be too much of a gap for the next one. Sorry about the previous gap. I have been working on kind of this, just going to do all these little baby fixes every single day and kind of put them together. The video just wasn't working out for me, so I decided to kind of scrap all that and start fresh. But I've got some exciting things coming up, especially our Liberator project, which is trucking along. I'm really excited to see how that all ends up. I'm pretty stoked. So, anywho, be safe, be sane, wear a mask if you're out in public, protect yourself and others, of course, and I'll see you next time. Bye.